morning. And
Merry Christmas.
So glad that you're all here this morning at St. John's. Welcome, welcome. My name is Pastor Chris Ryan. A special welcome to any first-time visitors that we might have here with us today. What a great day to just get together and worship and praise the newborn King. As way of a small gift to you this morning, I'm going to keep announcements pretty short here, just a couple things. First off, if you have not yet, in your pew there is a Connect card. We ask that you fill that out just so we know who was here, and as the card says, we can better connect with you after the service. Second, next weekend we will still have weekend worship services, even though Saturday is New Year's Eve and Sunday is New Year's Day. The Saturday service will take place at the normal time at 5 o'clock. It will be up here in the sanctuary, though. And then on Sunday morning, we will just have one service, and that will be at 10 a.m. If you would, join me in a word of prayer before we get started here. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this opportunity to be in your house and be about your business. Lord, we thank you that much like the shepherds and the angels on that first Christmas, in a certain sense, we get to go to Bethlehem this morning and we get to experience, enjoy, and celebrate the gift of the newborn King that is Jesus Christ. Lord, I ask that your Holy Spirit is present in this room, that any spirit of distraction may be gone, and may we fully focus on praising your name and Jesus' name. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this point, we'll open with our opening song, What Child Is This? And we will rise as the cross enters.
Salvation brings, let love
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy, seeking and imploring your grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who has given your only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins. And by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy upon us and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To those who believe on his name, he gives power to become the children of God and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
The first Christmas lesson is found in Isaiah chapter 52, verses 7 through 10. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your watchmen lift up their voices together. They shout forth joy. When the Lord returns to Zion, they will see it with their own eyes. Burst into songs of joy together, you ruins of Jerusalem. For the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord will lay bare his holy arm in the sight of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth will see the salvation of our God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second Christmas lesson is found in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 6. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty in heaven. So he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, you are my son, today I have become your father? Or again, I will be his father and he will be my son. And again, when God brings his firstborn into the world, he says, let all God's angels worship him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise in honor of Christ's gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the second chapter, beginning at the first verse. Glory to you, O Lord. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. This is the gospel of the Lord. Together as God's people, united in faith by his perfect gift, let us join together professing our common faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. At this point, if you have not yet, we once again ask that you fill out those Connect cards. And at this point, we'll have our ushers come down the side of the aisles, and they will collect them from you, if you could pass them to the outside. We will also continue with our song of the day, which is Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Thank you.
open my lips, and my mouth shall declare your praises in the name of Jesus. Amen. It's better to give than receive. Raise your hands if you've heard that one before. Now, keep your hands in the air if you think that that is true. Do you know that, strictly speaking, this is 100% true? It is a Bible verse, after all. Acts 20:35 says it's more blessed to give than to receive. That's why this Christmas season, far more of us will look forward to giving the perfect gift and seeing that reaction on the recipient's face than we'll look forward to receiving the perfect gift. Unfortunately, though a lot of us give good gifts at times, many of us give very, very bad gifts. And you don't have to look outside of simple statistics like this one to see just how true that is. Did you know that in America this year, $20 billion worth of Christmas gifts, just Christmas gifts, will be thrown directly into the trash? I'm no mathematician, but I think that's about $70 per person of gifts that are thrown directly away. And that's before we even get into the bad gifts we give that go entirely unused, yet not thrown away, collecting dust on a shelf, under the bed, or in your wallets. No, we give a lot of bad gifts. And the truth is, with that in mind, I think we could all use a little simple gift-giving advice. And that's exactly the gift I have for you right now. You see, when it comes to giving that perfect gift, studies show that this gift must only meet three simple standards, and they are as follows. First, the perfect gift will be valuable, and this is value as the recipient sees it. A lot of times this will mean monetary value, but it might mean some other sort of value as well. The perfect gift will also be thoughtful. It should be very clear to the recipient that you had them specifically in mind with the gift that you are giving them. It shouldn't look like some spur-of-the-moment impulse purchase. And the perfect gift will also fulfill a need that the recipient has. You meet all three of these standards, you're going to give one darn pretty good gift. If you only meet one or two, that gift might be entirely lacking. For example, I could give my wife for Christmas this year some Detroit Lions tickets. And she'd say, wow, these certainly are valuable NFL tickets after all, and isn't that the team that beat the Minnesota Vikings by 11 points just a few weeks ago? They must be pretty good. But I'll be honest. She'd say, I'm not a Detroit Lions fan. I don't care about watching their games. This doesn't fulfill a need for me, and I've never felt the need to take an all-expenses trip paid to Detroit. And beyond that, I'm not sure how thoughtful this is either, unless you were thinking about yourself. Or maybe just one more example. I could get my wife once again for Christmas a massage voucher, a free massage. And she'd say, wow, I've been needing one of these. My back muscles ache. My neck muscles are sore. But I'm not sure how valuable this thing is. Because this certificate, it's homemade, and it says the person giving me the massage is you. And as far as being thoughtful, the ink on this thing is still wet. I think you forgot to think about giving me a Christmas present. No. When we are going to give a perfect gift, it must meet all three of these standards. Now, where could he possibly be going with this? It is Christmas Day. You are in a church, after all, and there was a certain gift that we received, I don't know, about 2,000 years ago or so, that meets all three of these standards of the perfect gift. It's a gift given to you by God, who is, of course, the giver of every good and perfect gift. I'm talking about the gift of Jesus, of course. Jesus absolutely meets all three of these standards. He is of the utmost value. God puts significant thought into this gift that he gives just to you and his only son. And Jesus does fulfill a need that you have. In fact, I would say he fills your biggest need. Let's spend a few minutes together now just looking through how Jesus meets all three of these standards. We'll start with that first one, his value. And we can see that on full display in our epistle lesson this morning from Hebrews chapter 1. It says, the Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty in heaven. So he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. Within this passage, we can see a couple things that point to Jesus' extreme value. First off, if you caught it right at the end there, this passage says that Jesus is far more valuable than an angel. Who wouldn't want for Christmas for God to give them their own personal guardian angel? That would be extremely valuable. This passage says Jesus is more valuable. In fact, it says he's more valuable than all the angels combined. He's as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. Now, what is it that makes Jesus that valuable? Well, the passage says that as well. Jesus is so valuable because he is God. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. John 1, a gospel lesson that's being used in churches all throughout the country right now, says something similar. It calls Jesus the Word, and it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Jesus is God. This is an extremely valuable gift that God gives you of himself in God incarnate, Jesus Christ. This is the same God through whom all things were made. Without him, there was nothing that has been made. An incredibly valuable gift. And it's an incredibly thoughtful gift as well. You see, God didn't just look down 2,000 years ago and say, "Wait, is today Christmas? I forgot to get humanity something. Here, have the gift of my one and only Son, the Son I love." No, this is an extremely thoughtful gift that God gives to you in Jesus. In fact, in Revelation 13:8, it says that Jesus was the Lamb of God who was slain from the creation of the world. That speaks to just how much thought God put into this gift. What he is saying in that passage is that when it comes to Jesus, his life and death was a gift that was meant for you since before the world was even created. That is significant thought being put into a gift. 2 Timothy 1:9 says something similar, except watch as it goes even a step farther. It says, "God has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time." You want to talk about putting a thought into a gift? This was not a last-second gift here. This passage is saying that when it comes to Jesus, his life and death was a gift meant for you before the beginning of time. That is an incredible amount of thought that God puts into this gift just for you. And boy, is it a valuable gift as well. But I'm telling you, none of that would mean a thing if Jesus didn't meet the standard of the perfect gift in all three ways. Because in Jesus, your need, your biggest need, is fulfilled. How about a very important point, Christmas edition here? The gift of Jesus' life and death fulfills your biggest need to be forgiven of your sins. Humanity has no bigger need. And that's exactly what Jesus' life and death is all about. On the cross, he is giving you the gift of his perfect life, and he is giving you the gift of paying the price that you owed for your sins, and in doing so, you receive the forgiveness of sins. Now, why is that your biggest need? Well, Scripture makes it pretty clear. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. And that's not just talking about an earthly death. That's talking about an eternal death, eternal separation from God. But thanks be to God for his perfect gift. And thanks be to God that there is more to this verse than what is on the screen right now. Sure, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. What an incredible gift we get in Jesus. And it truly is a free gift. You have nothing to do with it. Ephesians 2:8 says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God." And it is an incredibly valuable gift, an incredibly thoughtful gift, and one that fulfills your biggest need to be forgiven. That is what Jesus is all about. And in Jesus, we get the gift that keeps on giving. You see, through Jesus, we get many more gifts. And I'm only going to talk about a couple of them today. First off, you get this incredible gift of the Holy Spirit. In Acts 2:38, it says, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit," a gift that flows from the gift. And from the Holy Spirit, you get even more gifts. You see, through God's Holy Spirit, you get someone that comes alongside of you in life, that comforts you, that guides you, and you get even more gifts. You get these incredible things that we could call spiritual gifts, and there are a lot of them. I don't even think that's all of them right there. In these spiritual gifts, you get gifts that help you love and serve God better and love and serve your neighbor better. And you want to talk about the gift that keeps on giving. The Holy Spirit, he also points you directly towards the fact that through Jesus you receive the gift of eternal life. Romans 6:23 again, the wage of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. And what is eternal life? John 17:3 says, "Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." In other words, eternal life, it's the gift of a relationship with God that starts now and lasts forever. You get to enjoy this gift right here, right now, as you take whatever you have going on in your life and you give it over to God, and you have someone who watches over you and loves you. And then that gift lasts all into eternity, as one day you get to go home to heaven with him and experience all of those many gifts as well. I'll tell you what, my prayer for you this Christmas day, it's very simple. I hope that you enjoy and pray that you experience the gift of Jesus Christ. May you experience this most valuable gift, this gift that God thought of just for you before time even began, this gift that fulfills your biggest need. And then may you experience all the gifts from the gift that keeps on giving. May you proclaim in the words of the Apostle Paul from 2 Corinthians 9:15, "Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift." May you do this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this point, we're going to have a little special music from our DCE here, Paul Nelson. Enjoy as he gives you his gifts today.
Starlight shines, the night is still. Shepherds watching from a hill. I close my eyes to see the night when love was born. A perfect child gently waits, a mother bends to kiss God's face. I close my eyes to see the night when love was born. Angels fill the midnight sky, and they our hearts, Bethlehem. see the night when love was born.
We continue with the prayers of the church, if you would join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you sent your Son, your only Son, the Son that you love, as a Christmas gift just for us 2,000 years ago. We thank you for how valuable he is and how much thought you put into this incredible gift. And we thank you that through Jesus' life and death, our biggest need is fulfilled. Our sins have been forgiven. May we now experience and enjoy this great gift that you have given us. May we experience Jesus daily. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we approach you now knowing that you are the giver of every good and perfect gift. And so we ask for the gift of your healing touch to be on everybody on our prayer list this morning. Lord, we ask for your healing touch to be in the lives of Tony Sabraski, of Ginny Meal, and of all those we name before you in our hearts and minds. We entrust these people into your healing hands, Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we ask that you're with all those who mourn. Be especially with Carol Berg and family upon the passing of John Berg. Lord, such a tough time to lose a loved one. We just ask this morning that you give Carol and family the gift of your peace, the gift of your love, the gift of your comfort, and the gift of your understanding. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we celebrate with those who celebrate. We thank you for the healthy birth of little Oren Lindquist to Jackson and Erica Lindquist this past week. We thank you for watching over mother and child in the hospital, and now we ask that you watch over little Oren all the days of his life. May he always know that you are his God and he is your child. Lord, in your mercy. And finally, Lord, we ask that you remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And as you leave this Christmas day to experience and enjoy God's greatest gift that he has given you, Jesus, may you receive God's blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. We close with the song, Joy to the World.